Hello, and welcome to the Keith Crawford Show. I'm your host, Keith Young. Tonight's topic for discussion is foot health and foot fashion. I've always wanted to do shows when we talk about our women and how they dress and how men, you know, the debates that we always do, you know, how women cram their feet into shoes. And later on in the day, only find that they're limping around or taking their shoes off. So I guess the cute part is over. But when we talked about getting the show together and talking about the skeletal foot and all this and that good old stuff, things kind of morphed when I have our guest, which you're going to be seeing in a couple of seconds. We talked more about, in depth about the foot, with fungi, calluses, and the heel, and all this and that good old stuff. So, you know, we had to get a podiatrist on, and lo and behold, we have Dr. Hicks from, and where are you from again, dear?
We're in New Haven, Connecticut.
Okay.
I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York.
Okay. All right. And the name of your organization, where you're at?
Affiliated Foot and Ankle Surgeons.
Okay. And that's on?
That's on Blake Street. It's 508 Blake Street on the Westville area of New Haven.
Okay. All right. And I really want to thank you for coming on, Doctor. Mm-hmm. I might slip at some time and call you Doc. I love calling doctors Doc. Right?
That's fine.
Great. Women. Right now, we're going to talk about women in shoes. I find a lot of times with stilettos or with really, really big heels that women are, they seem a lot taller, and it looks beautiful, it looks cute. But to what end are they doing so much damage to their feet? And we will be getting into the calluses, all that good old stuff. But are we really putting a little bit too much effort into what we wear on our feet to only later on, 10, 20 years down the road, we're limping and we're scuffling along?
Hmm. For women, shoes are important.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as like what we're going to wear, and I said what we're going to wear, because you know sometimes you have to wear the appropriate shoe with you know the appropriate attire, the occasion that you go into. But yes, this type of shoe that we choose to wear does put a lot of wear and tear on our feet, especially in the long term. Because you know now I have like older patients who are in their 60s and 70s, and now they're blaming their shoes. I should have never worn those shoes.
Mm-hmm.
But all in all, it's about the care.
Mm-hmm.
Of your feet. So if you wear a certain type of shoes, you have to know that you're not supposed to wear it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to switch your shoes, the type of shoe that you wear, in order mm-hmm. to take care of your feet.
Mm-hmm. It does do a lot of damage to the bone structure itself.
It does, because your foot is flexible, and that's why you're able to fit into these shoes like when you're younger.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're wearing shoes with the pointy toe, your foot will adapt to that eventually.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's why people end up with some bunions, and because of the cramping of the toes, you have what's called hammer toes, and you know corns on your toes, and your feet just looks discolored, and
mm-hmm.
then you don't want to put them out anymore.
They're not cute anymore.
Yes.
I'll say they're not cute anymore. All right, so let's start off with bunions, so to speak. Okay, is a bunion always a bunion? You know, your foot gets a big callus on it, or I don't know how it starts off, but you get a bunion on it. Is the old myth that you can put a Band-Aid on top of the bunion and put it back in those shoes again, or how does that work?
Well, what you can do for the bunion is basically the bump on the side of the big toe. So oftentimes you can get irritated with shoes, because now if you have this bump, which is the bone rubbing, a lot of times we do recommend like padding the area, and you can put a shoe on that's more comfortable. But if you want to put that shoe back on, it's not guaranteed that it's going to be pain-free,
mm-hmm.
because you have to wear a shoe that's wider to fit that bump.
Okay, all right. How do you get rid of a bunion?
Surgically. Yes, because once you develop the bunion, if you definitely want to get rid of that bump, have a straight toe again, is most likely surgery. Oftentimes, you can do things conservatively, like wearing like bunion splint that'll hold the toe straighter, but it won't really correct it.
Mm-hmm. So no matter what, so once a bunion starts, let me put it this way: once a bunion starts, is it a done deal? Or you can do something, you know, once you find that you're getting a bunion, is it a done deal? Or do you have to go ahead and get surgery, or is it something that you can do to ward things down and have a healthier foot?
You can pretty much prevent it from getting worse, you know, with certain things that you can do, like
mm-hmm.
the stretching exercises, the bunion splint, like kind of bring it over to
mm-hmm.
keep it from happening, avoiding those type of shoes
mm-hmm.
that will, you know, irritate and cause the bunion to get worse.
Mm-hmm.
Those are pretty much it. Sometimes we do put them in orthotics,
mm-hmm.
which people with flatter feet tend to get a bunion earlier.
Okay.
And also bunions is also hereditary too, so it's not just a shoe.
Okay. I have a lot of notes here, but I think that from your discussion, I'm going to wind up morphing into some other things. Now you talk about the flatter foot. Now, men get bunions too, correct?
Yes.
All right. And is that because of tight shoes that they wear or larger shoes that they wear?
Is because of the type of shoe they wear, you know, because men do wear shoes that are narrow in the front as well, mm-hmm. the dressier type
yes, we
shoes,
do. Mm-hmm.
especially the church shoes,
mm-hmm.
And hereditary.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So they can get, you know, if someone in the family has a bunion or a flat foot, they're more disposed to get that flat, to get the bunion deformity, especially
with
right?
flat foot.
So
it can be hereditary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's talk about calluses on a foot. Now, I have calluses on my foot. I was going to take off my shoe and put it on and put it on air, and I might still do that. I don't know. I have really ugly feet, you know, and I wear a more of a square-toed because my feet are pretty wide,
mm-hmm.
And I have calluses on my feet. How does one get calluses?
Calluses are from a couple of different reasons. The main thing is extra pressure. You know, in that area.
Okay.
So usually people have calluses along the balls of their foot when they're walking. So because when you walk forward, you put all the pressure on the front of your, along the ball, which is the bottom of your foot.
Okay.
And you can get calluses on the top of your toes, different areas, but it's pressure points. So it's either pressure from your weight, a lot excessive walking,
mm-hmm.
wearing the improper shoes that's not supporting you. So you can get calluses in these areas.
Uh-huh.
You can get calluses just from, like, you know, if your shoes doesn't fit properly, the shoe's not pressing on these bone areas, mm-hmm. and it can cause, like, the hardened skin.
Mm-hmm.
So calluses form in a way to protect your body, meaning that so the body is just like is building extra hard skin, thinking because now there's extra pressure there,
mm-hmm.
I need to build up this extra skin to protect the area for you. But if the callus builds up, it's hard skin,
mm-hmm.
and it's like having like a piece of rock attached to your foot, so it becomes painful.
Mm-hmm.
So it gets signals to you that, you know, there's something not right.
So we do. So as we go through the show, we do get signals about our feet.
Yes.
That says, okay, stop the motion. Mm-hmm. Let's get this checked out.
Yes. Stop okay. wearing these shoes.
So now, shoes. We're talking about shoes, but sneakers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I think a lot of my calluses came from the sneakers and the boots that I might wear during the wintertime of playing basketball. Can one get calluses a lot easier by wearing sneakers and playing ball? The ball player
mm-hmm.
get a lot of calluses.
With a lot of sports, you know, there's a lot of back and forth motion. So friction in the shoe, the rubbing back and forth,
okay.
you know, and then the excessive pressure on that area when you're playing that sport does cause calluses.
Okay.
So you do have, like, a lot of younger people who play basketball. Who get calluses along their toes.
Okay.
It's
okay.
very popular.
And what do you do about calluses? How do you get rid of the calluses? Is that surgically removed or something that you can do at home?
Calluses, you pretty much will have to, like, maintain them by either, like, using a pumice stone or a callus grater, something that will, like, pretty much shave the callus down.
Okay. Okay.
And you can keep it moisturized. There are lotions that can, you know, break down the hard skin.
Okay.
But it's something that you will have to maintain.
Now, Grandma and Grandpa back in the day used Epsom salt. Put a whole bunch of Epsom salt in that mm. little thing, and you put it in, and you loosen your feet. Does that stuff work?
What it does is softens the skin.
Okay.
So it makes that hard skin easy to remove.
Okay.
So, yes. And it, you know, soothes the feet, so.
I need heavy-duty Epsom salt on my feet, that's for sure. Let's get to fungi on the foot. Now, along with my calloused feet, they can smell pretty bad sometimes. Kids hate to smell them, but I would tease my grandchild with them, stick my sneaker in her face and let her smell them. I'm that kind
what?
Of guy. Where does that stuff come from?
Do they smell now?
They smell now. Yes,
okay,
they do.
Okay, we're going to have to take care
so
of
you're funny. What they do. So I'm not going to change. I'm not going to take my shoe off.
No, not today.
Okay, not today. Not today. I still might do. But where does the fungi come from? Where does that come from? Because on the bottom of the feet, you know, it itches and it turns a different color. Not mine, but it turns a different color and it itches. And mm-hmm. where's that from?
Well, it's like a fungus infection. So fungus live in hot, moist, dark environments, like inside your shoe.
Okay.
And then when you sweat, you know, your feet are sweaty, and the fungus can grow, and it goes in your skin, and it can go in your skin and get into your nails, and it has an odor, you know, so when you take your shoe off, then you notice it's smelling. But most of the odor is from the sweating
okay.
that occurs inside your shoe.
Okay.
So most of the time you have to wear something that's breathable. There's things that we can do, you know, in order to treat a fungus, so you don't have to go on living.
I don't have to go on living.
Like this
I have
anymore.
I just keep my shoes on
and
all the time.
Yeah, and we have, like, things to make your feet smell better, too. To do, just
you're funny. is fungi in the foot hereditary? My grandfather's feet stunk. My father's feet stunk. My feet stink. I mean, should I worry about my daughter's feet stinking at some point?
It's probably more related to having sweaty feet, maybe.
Okay.
You know.
Right. And that can be also be with
that
the
could be hereditary, like if you have like, you know, people who perspire more than the other.
Okay.
So that can be hereditary.
Okay.
But as far as the fungus, sometimes people who live in a household together, mm-hmm. it seems like everybody has it. It's probably because they're sharing, like, you know, showers, and they can catch it from, like, you know, gyms. Like, a lot of young children, people get it who go to the gym or who are in sports. Sharing the showers, definitely.
That's why the bathroom or the shower slippers are the best things to wear.
Mm-hmm. Wear shower slippers. The other place you should wear, like, slippers, too, is, like, when you go to, like, you know, hotels or you're walking barefoot on the floor. Like, certain places, you just want to protect your feet so you won't catch anything.
Yep. All right. Now, throughout the show, through our first segment, and by the way, we're going to be having this great performer that I met. You know, he's out of Bridgeport, Jwills. He's going to be coming on and sing two selections for us. We're also going to have later on in the show, Miss Nodella Jordan is going to be coming on for a heel that she, not that she necessarily invented, but something that she's interested in and she wants to do for plus-size women. So we're going to be getting back to that as well, so stay tuned. During this segment right here, though, Dr. Hicks, we're going to be having some slides flash up on the screen, and you know, it's gonna be like a little pop quiz. I want you to just tell us what, you know, might be popping up on the screen, just real brief, and then we'll go on to the next one. There's a few of them that we might probably get to, like four or five of them. So whenever that pops up, I'm gonna shut my big mouth up, and we're just gonna pop up something on the screen, okay?
Okay.
So you ready for that?
Yes, right. I see. Okay.
Now, what do we see here?
So what's this showing? Like the high heel shoe. It has a small platform wedge in the front part of it, which makes it a little bit easier to wear a higher heel, but what the picture on the right is showing is the, all the pressure that is going along the ball of the foot.
I see that,
See, when you put all that pressure, all your weight, like almost like two times your weight or more, is being placed there. So when you wear a shoe like this, if you're not used to it, then your feet will be aching like the next day. You're going to have pain along the ball of your foot, along the arch, if it's not something that you're used to wearing.
But now who's thinking about all of that pain when the shoe looks so doggone sexy?
Yeah, it does. And then, you know, it elongates the leg, you know, it shows off the calf muscles, and it's very attractive. And so they're not thinking about that at that point, but they will have to pay for it later.
All right, cool. What do we have here now? Now the flip-flop, the famous flip-flop.
The flip-flop, you know, everybody likes to wear these in the summertime, and they get them in every color. But if you are wearing this all day long and walking around in this flip-flop, it actually bothers your arch. Your arch is not supported. And so a lot of time you end up having pain along the arch. So what that picture on the right side of the flip-flop is showing is what's called the plantar fascia.
Okay.
It actually goes from the ball of the foot and inserts into the heel. And basically the band of tissue that helps support the arch.
Wow.
So that part where it inserts into the bone can become inflamed, and even the plantar fascia, if you excessively walk in these type of shoes.
Okay.
They're fun for, like, the beach, but not for every day.
And you know, again, you know, they look nice on a foot, you know, but Jesus, I mean, it looks like they're going to have a lot of pain later on. What are we looking at here, Doc?
This person, well, these people look like they have what's called hammer toes. That's when the toes kind of curl over.
Okay.
And they have, like, the bump on the joint.
Especially the red toenails over there, right?
Yeah, the red toenails. That shoe is too short. But it looks like they're trying to hold the toe back. Sometimes with these open-toe shoes, you end up sliding to the front of the shoe. So then the toe overhangs. And you don't really have much supporting it, like those little straps.
Okay.
And you're standing in it, so now the toes are tired and they're trying to grasp for anything.
Okay, we'll try to hit about two or three more clips. Now, what are we looking at there? See that?
That is the bunion we was talking
about
earlier.
That's the bunion.
Yeah, so this could be like a mild to moderate bunion. Everybody's bunion is different. Some people can have a bunion like this or even worse and have no pain, but that's what a bunion looks like on x-ray.
You know, and I always thought that the bunion had some kind of like callus on the side, but that's actually the bone that's protruding.
Yes, that's the bone that's protruding.
Wow, that's definitely some surgery. And how much does that hurt when you get that surgery done? That's something, I mean, how many people get scared away from getting that bone taken care of? I wouldn't get that bone taken care
of. Well, usually, well, if the bone hurts, you know, and you can't wear any shoe, then
you will get the surgery done.
Right. And you'll have discomfort probably for the first couple of days, but you do have pain medication that you take.
Okay.
So to make it comfortable.
All right, we'll show one more.
Yes, this is a hot, red, swollen joint.
Okay.
That we see a lot of this in our office, and most of the time there's no injury with this, and it's just pain, very tender to light touch, even like a bedroom sheet cannot touch it, and this is gout.
That's gout. So that's gout.
Yes.
What causes gout?
Gout is when you have a buildup of uric acid in your system, mm-hmm. and pretty much it goes like to cooler joints in the body, and it likes the great toe for some reason, mm-hmm. but it also can go into the knee. You can see it other places.
Is that right?
So it's caused by eating food rich in purine.
Okay.
And they're usually like organ meats, a lot of time in shellfish, seafoods. Most of the time I see people, I'm like, do you eat a lot of seafood? And, you know, we try to see what have they been eating in the past that may have caused it to flare up.
Okay. Now I've always seen what I thought was gout or the swollen foot in older people. Is that true? Do younger people get gout?
It's mostly in older people.
Mostly in older people. Mm-hmm. And that because of just of their ongoing diet with the...
Yeah, exactly. Okay. As you get older, there's some, you know, there's some things that you cannot eat. You know, you have to watch how, you have to stay hydrated. You have to make sure you drink lots of water.
Okay.
You know, you can't excessively eat one type of food.
Okay. Now, I want to ask this right here, and I don't know if you can answer this, but how soon, how long does it take? So if a person, say, a 15 years old, let's say a female, 15 years old, started using shoes that were weren't right, how long should they expect when by the time they're 20, 25 years old? Is there a number that you can put on taking care of, not taking care of your feet to the point of your feet being very, very bad? I mean, that 10-year span, 5-year span. How much time do folks have out there to change up their regimen of wearing shoes, sneakers, flip-flops, boots?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question. I think with everyone, it varies, you mm-hmm. know, on exactly what the deformity is, if we're talking about a bunion or a hammer toe, we're talking about calluses, mm-hmm. because if someone has a callus and a starting of a hammer toe, they can do things to just prevent it mm-hmm. from occurring.
Okay.
If someone has something like a bunion and it's caused by the shoe, some people can wear certain shoes mm-hmm. and they have a bunion and it just doesn't hurt.
Mm-hmm.
So they can go forever, you know, 20, 30 years. There's no telling, because it's not everyone that has that foot problem.
Mm-hmm.
It's the thing that everybody, there's the average foot,
mm-hmm.
and the average foot probably can wear most shoes
mm-hmm.
all the time,
mm-hmm.
but then there's some people who can't. So it's hard to say, really.
Mm-hmm.
I have some people who are in their 90s, and then they have a bunion deformity, and it never hurt them the whole life. They wore whatever shoe they wanted to wear. The foot is deformed, yes, but they don't have any pain.
Okay.
But there's some people with the smallest bunion and just can't wear anything, not even a sneaker.
Okay.
So they get it corrected right
okay.
then and there.
Okay.
And then it could be 16-year-old.
Okay. Now, I read in some of the notes that you had, and you gave me a wealth of notes. We're not going to get to all of these notes, but I read something that really, really got me that said the average person walks, in their lifetime, walks around the world 3 times. Is that how much we're really using our feet?
Yes, we are on our feet constantly,
mm-hmm.
you know, and there's holding all that weight, and then we have the gravity pulling us on. So mm-hmm. it's like we're putting, yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's the average. That's a statistic. I mean, I never really calculated it myself.
Right. You don't walk around the world 3 times or anything like that.
No, I don't think so.
And your lifetime is not up yet.
I don't know.
But I just wonder, you know, how people really take their feet for granted. It's like, okay, I got my feet. I'm good. I'm going to get up. I'm going to walk. I'm going to get up. I'm going to run. I'm going to put these on. But we're not mm-hmm. really thinking about the health of our foot. And it's just as important as our heart, as our eyes, as our brain. Do you find people being foot conscious, so to speak, when they come into your office, or you think that people are a lot, they lack foot conscious?
We have both,
mm-hmm.
because people who are foot conscious are really concerned about, they want to know what's going on with their feet. There are some people who just come in, they don't know anything about it, but I think most of the people that come are conscious about something. Either they have pain and they want it resolved, or they're extra cautious.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether they be a diabetic,
mm-hmm.
and they want to make sure that their foot examined to
mm-hmm.
make sure that everything is going all right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I want to get to the diabetic part of this right here, because that's one of the most intriguing things when I was sitting down going through our little interview, and you had said almost a little bit more, a little bit less than 50% of the clients that come through your doors have problems with their feet because of diabetic. What is so big? Why is that so big coming through your office?
Oftentimes, people with diabetes, first of all, is very important to have their foot examined at least, you know, twice or once a year. And then where we are located in New Haven, we have a lot of people with diabetes that have what's called neuropathy.
Okay.
And neuropathy is pretty much when they lose sensation in their feet.
Okay.
So obviously they cannot feel.
Okay.
So all the simple things is like wearing a shoe that's not fitting properly, they might not know. So they can end up with these deformities, they can end up with calluses. And the problem with that is that the calluses can end up turning into something that's called an ulcer, okay. which is a wound. Remember that signal I was telling you about?
Yes.
When you have that callus, it hurts,
yes.
and you want to get rid of it.
Yes.
The diabetic patient does not get that signal because they don't have any sensation in their feet.
Okay.
So they can end up with like a wound, an open sore, and not even know it. And this is something that can become infected, you know. Okay. And sometimes people end up losing, like, you know, toes, limbs, just because of something that started off as a callus.
Right,
and
right.
was not evaluated.
Is that right? Something that might have started off as a callus that was not evaluated can turn into diabetes, and which result in the removal of one of their limbs, one of your toes, or the whole foot.
Mm-hmm. That's
correct. Real deep. That's real deep. That's real deep. The last part I want to talk about before we introduce my man, Mr. Jwills, the bone spurs. Now, there's been times that I get up in the morning and it feels like there's something just pulling at my foot. Is that a bone spur? It's something that's just like, it feels like it's just pulling and just grabbing at my foot, and it won't go away. It seems to simmer down, but mm-hmm. that sucker hurts really, really bad. Is that a bone spur, or what is bone spurs?
Well, is it the pain that you have in your heel, like along the arch area?
In my heel, yes.
In the heel. So if you wake up first thing in the morning, you take that first step, and it hurts, and you can't really walk first couple of steps, you're just trying to get comfortable, it's your plantar fascia. Remember that picture I showed you mm-hmm. with that band of tissue?
Yes.
So that becomes inflamed in the heel. So when you're sleeping at night, you're kind of resting, but when you go to stand up, you pretty much like stretched it all out, and it becomes inflamed into the heel bone. Over time, you will develop like a spur in that heel bone,
okay.
and basically it's the plantar fascia pulling on it.
Okay.
Over the time. So it's not the bone actually that hurts, it's basically the inflammation in that area.
Inflammation in that area.
Yeah, so it's basically, you know, from wearing, like, if your shoes are not supportive, or if you do a lot of walking, a lot of activities, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. weight gain can cause it. There's a number of things that can cause you to have.
How do you think, like, dancers like Michael Jackson, Usher, and those guys didn't have anything wrong with their feet? I mean, they did a lot of stuff on their feet and all that moving and turning and spinning. I mean, it's just... Did you have a, like, your own special podiatrist?
Probably. I was about to say, how did you know they didn't have anything wrong with their feet? Yeah, they probably get massages, soaks on the regular, you know.
Now, about massages. How often should a person get their foot massaged? Should it be every single day?
As often as they can, because it feels good.
But women seem to get away with that, you know, I need my foot massaged. You need my foot massaged. Massage my foot. Massage my foot.
Yes, there's foot massages. Necessary.
Yeah. Okay. Listen. Thanks, Doc. We're going to get back to the doc in a little bit. We're also going to have Miss Odella Jordan to be coming on to talk about her heel, or the heel for plus-size women. We can't forget about plus-size women because they actually wear the same shoes. So she's going to be coming on the set a little bit after Mr. Jwills is going to be coming on. And just, folks, just to let you know, make sure you stay on. Don't even go to the bathroom. Hold it. Okay? Because after Mr. Jwills sings this song, we have Mr. Odell on. We're going to talk to Jwills just a little bit and have him sing his number one hit on his CD. But right now, we have Mr. Jwills coming on to do his things. I'm glad I met this guy. I think you're going to love him, too. We'll be back after Mr. Jwills does his thing. Mr. Jwills, please.
Can't believe. Ooh, oh, oh, oh. No, no, no.
Listen,
baby girl, I don't know what's wrong with us, but I thought I was sure that you were the one. I will spend my life loving you like I do, but the more we try, our love has fallen apart. But I can't believe
this happened.
Can't believe. Baby girl, you know.
Though we try hard to make things work.
We try.
But more it seems we're growing apart.
I remember quite well used to hold you in my arms. As we look into each other's eyes, and we made so many promises, never thought that it would come today. Now here it is, we've gone our separate ways. I regret that we've been torn apart, so far that it left pain in my heart.
I can't believe this is happening.
Yes, it's happening.
It's like a dream.
It's like a dream.
It's real.
And it's real.
Though we try hard to make things work.
We try. Baby girl, it's happening.
I can't believe this is happening.
Yes, it's happening.
It's like a dream.
It's like a dream. And baby girl, you know.
Though we try hard to make things work.
We try.
But more it seems we're growing apart.
I can't believe it's tearing us apart.
I can't believe this is happening.
Oh no.
It's like a dream.
It's like a dream. Apart, baby. Yeah, no. I can't believe. I really do. I love you, baby girl. Yes, I do. Oh, no. But I can't believe. Oh, babe, I can't believe. Goodbye, babe. I just can't believe, but I can believe. Goodbye, babe.
Get in his head a little bit, see what's going on, Mr. Jwills. But again, thank you so much. Stay tuned for Mr. Jwills' featured song on his CD. And back on the set, ba-dow, we have Miss Nodella Jordan. How you doing?
Good, and yourself?
All right, so I have two lovely young ladies on the set to talk about feet. Who would have been thinking, huh? So Miss Nodella,
yeah.
We were talking one day, and the conversation came up about women cramming their feet. I'm always talking about women, because only I can talk about women, because I'm not afraid to talk about women. But I have two ladies on the show right now, so let me shut up. We talked about the heel, and the conversation came up about what about plus size women?
Yeah.
You know, how do they get their feet in these things, or are they left out,
yeah,
you know, of the party scene or the wedding scene where they can't wear some of the same shoes that, you know, average size women would wear?
Yeah.
Everybody loves plus size women, plus size men, but men don't have that same problem. You know, our shoes are, and our sneakers are pretty much down to earth, but women, you know, they have to pick themselves up a little bit,
yeah,
to get the men, but that's a whole nother show. Talk to me about the plus size heel, so to speak.
Well, basically, growing up, just watching women's shoes over the years develop, one of the things that I noticed is there was an issue with the clothing for women who were plus size, or what I tend to call full-figured women, and
mm-hmm,
then they finally began to create clothing for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you would think that in the 21st century, the shoe would have caught up as well as with the attire, but I'm seeing that it has not quite caught up. I see a lot of women trying to wear the same heels that I wear, and if they're uncomfortable for me, I know they're even more uncomfortable for the plus-size woman.
Mm-hmm.
And it bothers me that they have to force their foot in a shoe that really was not made for them. I have spoken with a number of women, you know, just over a time period, whereas they have to buy a shoe anywhere from a half size to a full size larger just to get their foot in because it's not made wide enough. There are shoes that are labeled wide width, but you have some women whose feet are actually wider than the wide width.
Now, hold it right there. Now, is this where the callus or the bunions come in, where they have to buy Would it have to get shoes that are that much more wider, that much more bigger, that rubbing and back and forth, Doc? Is that where this they're prime candidates for that right off the rip before they even buy the doggone thing?
Once they get it, yes, that's where a lot of problems can come, you know, or, you know, like, you know, straining the foot because they're forcing their foot in a shoe that doesn't fit.
Okay, no doubt. So you haven't invented the wheel over again. There have been heels out here, but yeah. Talk about this heel. I mean, what does this heel look like?
Well, a lot of women are caught up in the stiletto, and as we saw in the previous slides, stilettos are some of the most prettiest shoes, but they can be very hurtful. I have a few pair of stilettos.
A few pair, not just one, but a few pair.
A few pair
of stilettos.
I just want
to be making a point, that's all.
And, I mean, I have what I would think an average size foot, but sometimes my feet are hurting after I take them off.
Let's be honest, both of you ladies, okay? Now, Doc, you work with feet, ankles, and feet. Lodell, you know about what it can do. Do both of you own shoes that can potentially hurt your feet? I mean, are you in those same?
I think, like, certain shoes have the potential to hurt your feet, but you do have certain shoes, but you have to wear it for the right occasion. And not everybody can wear a heel. There's even, you know, people, you have to practice to wear these heels.
Okay. Now, you say practice. You know, I want to get you back to your thing, but you said practice. You know, we were talking out earlier, on the lobby earlier, and I brought up the thing. I work in the Head Start program with 3 and 4 year old kids, and we have dramatic play areas. And in those dramatic play areas, there are princess shoes with heels on them. And we see our little girls clobbering around through the classroom, having fun, doing their thing, with these heels on. So it starts young.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I think we keep on going back to is moderation.
Yeah.
Where are these things going to eat in moderation, sleep in moderation, wear your shoes in moderation. So. You've been working on this heel. You have this idea about a heel.
Yeah.
And you've been, I mean, you've mentioned Dr. Scholes or what's going on with that?
Yeah. Well, one of the things I believe, in the event that we purchase a shoe that we just absolutely have to have, in the store it feels good, but generally once we get it home and begin to wear it, that's when we find the discomfort. And currently on the market, they do have inserts that you can put in your shoes to help comfort your feet. But my desire is to have a shoe created with that comfort sole already in there.
Okay.
But it's not a cure-all for the problems with our feet. The problem is that they have a standard shoe that's made. Most shoes are made in a standard pattern. I don't care how they design it. It's made for a certain foot. And at least, I'm just kind of throwing out a number, at least 30 to 40% of the female population foot is not meant to wear that particular shoe. But we cram our foot in it anyway because we just have to have it. It's either the latest shoe or, as the doctor said, you know, we have this certain function we're going to and we want to have a certain look. And so we will pay the price at that time, not realizing there's a greater price later on.
Come on, Nodella. We know, you guys know, that when you buy those skinny shoes, it's going to hurt your foot at some point.
No, we don't give it any thought. I am actually a patient of her practice where she works at, because I've been wearing heels since as early as 5 years old.
Okay.
Because my mother wore 4-inch, 5-inch heels. I used to play in them, so that's all I wanted to wear once I got up to age. My first pair of heels were 4-inch heels when I was 13 years old.
13 years old. Mm-hmm.
And I pretty much wore heels every day. As a doctor, it's not good to wear them every day, but because I'm only 5'4", I wanted to feel a little taller, I was wearing 3-inch heels practically every day. And one of the things that began to happen is because I was wearing them all day, every day, over time. Now, I'm now 45. When I had the surgery, I was 39 or 40 years old. So you're talking from the age, let's say, 13 to 39 years old. That's 26 years it took for that bunion to finally form on my foot. And because I feel that I do have pretty feet and I did not want my foot disfigured, I immediately ran to her practice and told my doctor, I want this removed off my foot now. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so I did have to have surgery. The bunion wasn't that bad. I was mm-hmm. supposed to have both feet done, but I only had the right foot done. Mm-hmm. And after I had the right foot done, my left foot actually felt a lot better, so I just had the right foot done. Mm-hmm. And his advice was to me, come out of those heels.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, I got something here. One doctor said 40% of her patients have been pain because of high heels. 40% of her patients.
Yeah.
So, what do plus size women have to look forward to? We got the clothes. Mm-hmm. I mean, let me ask this right here, real quick. Do you see a bigger market now for plus size women with shoes than before? And you know, how close is that gap?
There is a somewhat larger market, but mm-hmm. it's not large enough. Mm-hmm. There needs to be a market to where, once again, I feel if a woman sees a shoe mm-hmm. and she wants to purchase it, she can afford it, she should be able to, but not at the expense of the health of her feet. Mm-hmm. And once again, we shove our feet in these shoes later on, paying the ultimate price. My desire is to create a shoe wide enough mm-hmm. to fit a woman. My daughter, prime example, she has what is called a quad E width, which is four E's.
Okay. Now talk to me, what's four E's? About how?
That means she has a very wide foot. My daughter has a very chunky foot. She had a chunky foot since she was a baby.
Okay.
And we had to buy her certain shoes
okay.
that otherwise she would not have been able to wear.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
When I was growing up, we had stride right. That was
okay.
the first shoe we ever put
stride
on
right.
our foot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Stride right was the first shoe we put on our foot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And my parents made sure that as we grew up that we had shoes to support our feet. So right now I have a pretty healthy arch, but I know a number of people who have flat feet,
mm-hmm.
You know, and flat feet that also causes problems. And people or women with flat feet trying to wear a 3-inch or 4-inch heel, that is even more painful.
Okay, okay. I love this right here. But I'm going to say this, fellas, we have a way out now, okay? You don't have to buy that shoe for your girl. You can say, baby, that's going to hurt your foot. Why spend the money on this shoe right here? We're going to have to go to the doctor later on. Get this shoe instead. Are you with me? Are you with me?
No.
No. Okay. But it's a good one. Shane's laughing. Women are 4 times more likely to have foot problems than men. True? False?
True.
Why so?
Because we wear a lot of different types of shoes.
Okay. All right. Makes sense. Now, I always wear, no matter what, I'm going to buy Nike sneakers. But Nike sneakers run a little bit different than what Converse sneakers and what ponies and all that stuff does. So I know I have done some damage to my pinky toe, I think, because it gets really tight around in that area where the Converse, I just don't want to wear those sneakers. I like Nikes. Just as women want to wear their certain mm-hmm. shoe, it's the same thing with me when it comes down to sneakers. Shoes, I don't care. If they're black, square toe, they feel good, I'm good. I can't wear the pointy shoes, though some guys can. A 2-inch heel can increase the load of the forefoot by 75%. What is that? I mean, by 75%?
Mm-hmm. That's pretty much all your body weight is being forward yeah. to the front of your foot with the heel.
Wow.
So that higher the heel, the more pressure you're putting
yeah.
to the front
wow.
of your foot.
Wow. So it pays to be cute, huh? It pays to be cute. It costs to be cute. Again, men, loophole. They don't have to be that cute, man. If you love them, they love you. Put the shoes aside, man. Stride right? Those things, they still sell those things? They still got
that
the things out?
That was back in our day.
Let's bring them back. Let's bring sexy back with the Stride X. And let's put them in different colors, different flavors. Oh, why not? Approximately 56,000 people a year lose their foot or leg due to diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
That's big. And I hate to jump around, but mm-hmm. you want to say something, Doc?
Yeah, I mean, like we were saying before with the diabetes, is usually by not going to see a podiatrist, not having the foot examined. You know, these people no one looks at their feet, it stays in the shoe, you know. So people who have diabetes, I strongly urge them to just get a basic, like a foot evaluation, and if they say you're okay, then you're okay, but to definitely, you know, mm-hmm. check that out, because those are some high statistics.
And as a doctor, I have to say that this wasn't in my notes, but when I hear about go get checked out, you know, go see your doctor, you know, a lot of folks don't have insurance. Mm-hmm. A lot of folks don't have the insurance that would fit the need of going to a podiatrist or something like that, or a specialist or something like that. So, you know, we're always going to get back into that thing. You know, even talk about eating, we talk about our heart, we talk about our health. It's still getting to that doctor. We got to get to the doctor. But, you know, insurance is so key. You know, so people out there lobbying for insurance for our folks that really can't afford it, please keep on pushing that, because we have to see a doctor at some point for something. Mm-hmm. And I just can't keep on getting over how much we need our doggone feet. Mm-hmm. You know, I would say to some people sometimes when walking, say, you know, how you doing today? I'm not doing too good. I say, at least you got your feet to walk with, you know, you're not walking around one leg. We need our feet. That's what they're made for. Mm-hmm. And let me ask you something, Doc. I mean, are all five toes really necessary in order to walk? I always want to know that right there. I mean, the Flintstones only have four toes, man. But we have five, the Flintstones. Anybody remember the Flintstones? Anyway, five toes. I mean, are all five toes that important for us to have in order to?
I mean, they're not that important to have, mm-hmm. but they basically help with balancing. Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you don't necessarily need all five toes, but for balancing purposes, yes.
Okay, okay, for balancing purposes. Okay. Nodella.
Yeah.
How far are you into the stage of really making your dream, your American dream? And that's a little segue into Jwills. But how far are you into making your having your American dream, your dream of this shoe?
I'm.
This is not what you do for a living.
No, this is not what I do for a living.
Okay.
This is something that came about around 4 years ago, and once again, just evaluating women wearing shoes, and even myself, I have name brand shoes, and although they are name brand shoes and they're very cute shoes, mm-hmm. but they were very hurting as well. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And a lot of women at my church specifically, 10 minutes after getting that church, they're peeling their shoes off, putting on slippers. Mm-hmm. And I don't feel that we should be investing that amount of money in a shoe that we can only tolerate to wear for 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of money that's being wasted, and some women don't even wear the shoe ever again. And mm-hmm. But I would say about halfway through, I've enlisted a couple of design artists who did the sketches for me, and they go from a sketch to a CAD into a render, and the render is actually the last stage where I will present it to a manufacturer. And they would take that, and that's where they would begin to actually manufacture the shoe. But I have to get the shoes patented first, because I don't want anyone to steal my design.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And once I get the patent done, then I go into production. Mm-hmm. So, but I'm also looking, you know, for funding sources, because it's very expensive, and mm-hmm. one who's trying to break into the market, it can be very difficult, as you know, the same as being an artist or an actor, you know, trying to break into a certain profession, you know, it can be difficult.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Doc, I got to ask you this right here, because, you know, we asked Nodella what she got, you know, what got you into, is it podiatry? What got you into that?
Mm-hmm. Good question. I've always wanted
to. You know, I've had two questions. That's the second time saying that, but go ahead.
Because, like, it's not really an interesting answer, at least not to me it isn't, mm-hmm. but I was always interested, like, in the medical profession. I wanted mm-hmm. to be a doctor, but I didn't really know where I wanted to go with it. Mm-hmm. And I pretty much visit different specialties, different doctors. I volunteer at the hospital just so I could get acquainted with, you know, what goes on in the hospital setting. And then I ran into a podiatrist through one of my good friends. And we actually just, you know, stayed in their office, see how they did. And I was attracted to it because, like, everybody that came to see him would, like, hug them and kiss them. And, like, this was, like, the only office I went to where patients were kissing the doctor, like, hugging. And I was like, oh, okay, everybody likes this. And then that's how I got more interested into it. And then I decided to apply to school. And that was, like, the only medical school I applied to. And then I got in, and I, here I am.
Well, you know, and I do want to say this, and I wasn't going to say this, but I have to say this. I have never seen a woman of color as a podiatrist. You know, it was like, wow, you know, that's pretty cool, you know. And, you know, to have you on the show today, along with Nodella, you know, I really, 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 really appreciate it. We're going to be getting to Mr. Jwills in a second, so I want you guys to think about some questions you or some statements you might have while I go over here and do my Don Cornelius thing over here with Mr. Jwills. But thank you so much for coming on. He's about to do another song, so I'm going to talk to him real quick, okay?
Okay.
All right. So, folks, I'm about to get up and go walk over to Mr. Jwills really, really quick and let him do his thing, okay? So, ladies, sit tight. And while I am walking, I'm going to say, guys, seriously, you do not have to buy those shoes if you don't want to buy those shoes. You guys gave us the end right here. But Mr. Jwills, how you doing, bro?
Pleasure to meet you. Pleasure to have me.
Man, I tell you, it's something else to have you on the show today. You know, out of Bridgeport, Connecticut. But you come from originally from Africa.
West Africa. Liberia, yes.
Now, how did you get here? I mean, how did that whole thing happen?
Well, I came with actually my grandmother with a church group.
Okay.
You know, just coming for education.
Okay. Okay.
And that's how I, you know, ended up in the States.
Okay, and where did singing come from?
Well, it all started back home, you know, where I used to love music, love turntables.
Okay.
I actually used to craft turntables with like styrofoam and Babylon sticks, believe it or not.
Okay, okay.
I just played with it, and it was a passionate thing for me. My parents, my family played music all the time.
Okay.
Grew up in the disco era.
Okay.
70s child, you know.
Okay, okay.
And basically, that's, it just synced all in me.
Yep. Now, you cut hair?
Yes.
Okay, you own your own cosmetologist. Okay, that's a better way to put it.
Headquarters barbershop in Bridgeport.
Okay, in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Okay, and how long have you been singing, bro?
I've been singing probably, I did mostly producing and teaching other artists how to sing certain things on records, but eventually I just had the feeling that I needed to get in the booth. So
I just got
in the booth and here it is.
Okay. Now, the main song that you're going to be singing tonight for us is going to be American Dream.
Yes, that's my brand new single.
What was the name of that first song you sang, though?
Because Loving You More.
Because that song right there, I mean, I love American Dream, but I said, Jay, you got to sing this song right here. I was really feeling that, man. That's my favorite, and folks are going to love American Dream. Right? I know they're going to love American Dream. Okay. But where did American Dream come from? What was that all about?
Well, American Dream is a wide aspect. I think, you know, me, myself, I'm living an American Dream because having the opportunity to come from another country to this country to live out my dreams and goals, you know things that I want to get at and what I want to accomplish in life.
Okay.
And be able to accomplish those things is actually a great thing for me as an American Dream. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And every individual, there's something that they would like to accomplish in life. So they can look at this song as, what can I do for my American Dream?
Okay.
No matter what part of
we all have an American, we all have some kind of dream, some kind of man. My dream is to be a talk show host. Not doing too good at it, but hey, I'm here right now, ain't I? With Jwills. Now, Jwills, lastly, in closing, you have something going on. You have some kind of a contest going on or something like that.
Talk to me about
that.
The American Dream contest. Basically, when I came to the States, my father gave me $1,000, and I took that $1,000 and I bought some turntables.
Okay.
So that was the start of my American Dream. So what I want to do is to give away $1,000 to someone who can, is actually a contest to start the American Dream.
Okay.
And basically the way it goes is you have to log on the website and just find out all the information on it. It's at www.lasmove.com. That's LASMOUVE.com. You know, log on, check it out. Be a part of the dream and support the Lasmove and Jwills movement.
Okay, and if you folks didn't catch that, you can always hit me up on my email, thekeithcallsitshow26@gmail.com. I'll respond back, give you that information.
Yes,
and at the same time, Jwills, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show. Love you like
thank
a play cousin, man.
Me.
Do your thing right now. We're going to get back to the set.
Okay.
Do your thing, baby, okay? Jwills, American Dream.
Coming to the music scene, Jwills' name. He's bringing them banging beats, gonna make you dance. Coming to the music scene, Jwills' name. He's bringing them banging beats, gonna make you dance. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American dream. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American. Pull up at the game in my Lamborghini, dressed GQ in the magazine. Status up high like a mezzanine. Consider me blessed, I'm getting that green. Work around the clock to fulfill a dream. It's all paying off, now I'm living well. Pockets full of papers, ain't hard to tell. Fine suits, Gucci boots, and my closets fail. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living in American dream. I'm living in American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. Come on, verse 2. I'm living in American, American. Big house on the hills holding four wings. Getting served by the maid as I'm walking in. 10-plus chairs I'll be lounging in. LCD screens, 99-inch. PS3 games, it's how I'm entertained. 100 bottles at the bar, I be sipping drinks. Pretty woman by the pool, we getting it in. It's the dream that I'm living, I'm taking it in. Come on. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American dream. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living in American, American. Driving to the coast, cruise on a yacht. Summer breeze in the air, I'm in paradise. 4 trips every year just to keep relaxed. Go trips in the deck just about the ice. More drinks by the deck, buried by the ice. Top shelf in my glass and I'm feeling nice. If you had a dream, you would live with dreams. Big dreams come through if you pay the price. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American dream. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living in American, American. Back in the city where the lights are pretty. Families and friends dance where the music is playing. Enjoying good times, good life is part of living. Pull up to the mall, a shopping spree for us all. Loving the mall and the stores, we going in and out. Picking up jewels, shoes and clothes, cause we spending out. Cause life is too short, you gotta live it out. And if you have a heart to give, you gotta give it out. Come on. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American dream. I'm living an American dream. If you ever had a dream, you would know what I mean. I'm living an American dream. I'm living it up. I'm living it up. I'm living it up. The American dream. Living it up. I'm living it up. I'm living it up. The American dream. Come on. I'm living it up. I'm living it up. The American dream. Shout out to Keep Young Show. Thanks for having me, y'all. It's good appreciation. Check out Jwills, lostmove.com, www.lostmove.com. Jwills, the music is in me. It's the album. Peace.
Now that's what I'm talking about, Mr. Jwills, ladies and gentlemen. He will be back on this show. Mr. Jwills was on the Connecticut Channel 12 News, I believe it was. I looked at some things on YouTube. He's all over YouTube. Look him up, Jwills. And there was something that he had done. There's some violence going on in Bridgeport. And Connecticut News had sought him out, had him come on and perform. And we will be having a show on community violence in the very near future. Mr. Jwills will be coming on to do something else. If we can get him before he gets too big time on us, anyway. I want to make a quick announcement. New Haven Public Schools Head Start Program is still accepting applications for 3- and 4-year-olds. This 2013-2014 school year. Available slots are at the Early Childhood Learning Center, ECLC at 495 Blake Street, and the Ziegler Center at 81 Olive Street. If you're still interested, call up 946-6950. That's 946-6950 or 946-6179. That's 946-6179. New Haven residents only. That's area code 203. You see the email address up there. If you have any questions about Jwills, Head Start slots, the heel, definitely the foot and ankle. I keep on saying the foot, but it's ankle is most important as well. About podiatry, any question you might have about that, hit me up. I'll be your link between those folks right there until you get settled in. All right, but this is what the Keep Calling Show is all about. It's outreach about information. It's sharing love with local artists, local folks. Doc, you are A number one. I mean, when I met Doc, she was, seemed very shy to me. I thought she was like, pretty much like didn't like me or something like that at first. But
real cool. I really appreciate you coming down and representing your agency and wealth of information. And, of course, we didn't have enough time in the show to talk about everything, but we want to bring awareness to folks about the health of the foot. And, you know, why limp around when you can walk around? You know, why be in a wheelchair if you don't have to be in a wheelchair? You know, and if you get that sensation in your feet, get it checked out. You know, sometimes you might just say that my foot is numb and you know, I don't feel too good today. My feet are hurting. Go to the doggone doctor. But let me ask you this. Should they go to an orthopedic or should they go to a podiatrist? Which one should they go to?
If they're having like foot and ankle problems, then they should see a specialist, a podiatrist, someone who specializes in the foot and in the ankle, who from everything from like an ingrown toenail to, you know, ankle surgery, ankle fractures, sprains. If anything's wrong with your foot, you know, if there's something wrong with your eye, you go to your eye doctor.
That's right.
You know, so.
That's right. That's the funny thing. You know, something's wrong with your eye because we can't see. You know, I got to go to the doctor. I can't see. Or something's wrong with a hand because but the foot, we'll limp around on that, and we should not do that. You know, in all jest, you know, we women wear what they wear because that's what they want to wear. They feel comfortable with that.
Yeah.
I think it's because they want to impress the men, and the men got to pay more money. That's a whole nother show, right, Shane? But anyway, we want to make sure that, you know, we know that, you know, in all jest, you know, women wear what they want to wear.
Yeah.
It does make them look good. You know, it is attractive. But we have to be more self-conscious about how long we're wearing them, and we're feeling a little bit of pain, get it checked out. Mm-hmm. So, Doc, real quick, in closing, if a person's foot is hurting because they think they have on a certain shoe, should they just go ahead and change the shoe, or do they immediately go to a podiatrist or go to their general practitioner?
I think they should try and change the shoe first.
Uh-huh.
You know, if you do a shoe modification and you try, like, an anti-inflammatory, like Tylenol or ibuprofen, something like that, and the pain is not going away after 2 weeks, you should definitely be seen.
Okay.
If you have an injury, you should be seen right away.
Okay, right away. And especially, I'm really concerned about the diabetes stuff, you know, and that gout. You know, if you feel something in your foot, if something's looking crazy in your foot, get it checked out. Lodella, love you like a play cousin. Love you like a play cousin. Jwills, you my man. Folks, I'm looking to get Kermit on the show. We want to talk to Kermit, do a one-on-one. Next month, we're going to be having pediatric dentistry on. We're going to have Dr. Keck on from Yale to come on and talk about children and young teeth. Very, very important show. It's all about self-esteem, that smile. Listen, I want to have a debate. If I have any people out there in the local town that can sing, that can rap, want to perform on the Keith Colvin Show, hit me up, the Keith Colvin Show, 26@gmail.com. Love you like a play, cousin. Love you guys. Citizen Television, thank you so much. We out.
Good job.